In Portal, Portal 2, and other Source Engine-based games, we can shoot through certain seams between two walls, even though no gap between them can be seen. This glitch is known as a Seamshot. To understand how it works, we need to look at how the game handles collision with brushes. Brushes are convex shapes which are used to create basic level geometry in Source Engine games. In terms of ray collision, we can distinguish two types of brushes: axis-aligned boxes, which we'll be referring to as simple brushes, and any other shapes with at least one non-axis-aligned face, which we'll be referring to as complex brushes. The code for colliding rays with brushes is implemented differently for these two types. However, what both of the algorithms have in common is that they effectively attempt to make brushes slightly larger. More specifically, all planes constructing a brush are moved outwards by a small distance called epsilon. This was done to prevent hit points having direct contact with the brush, which presumably could lead to Z-fighting or problems with collision. Since each of these brush types has a different collision algorithm, a different way of implementing this distance offset is used. Let's start with simple brushes, that is, axis-aligned boxes. As previously mentioned, the ray collides with a larger version of the original brush, with each face moved out by a distance epsilon. What's interesting is that the ray has to collide with the original brush first in order for collision to even be considered. Only then is the larger version used to determine a hit point. This means the hit point is affected, but the actual collision detection remains unchanged. Since we're mostly interested in collision detection, we're just going to represent simple brushes in their original size for the rest of this video. Collision with complex brushes is slightly more complicated and requires a more detailed explanation. For each plane forming a brush, signed distances of the start and end point of the ray to the plane are measured. If the point is in front of the plane, the distance is positive, and if it's behind, it's negative. If the ray passes through the plane, we use these distances to calculate a fraction telling us how far along the ray this intersection happens. We call this an entry fraction if the ray enters the plane, that is, starts in front of it and ends behind it, and an exit fraction otherwise. Once every plane is checked, the biggest entry fraction is compared to the smallest exit fraction. If it's smaller, we know the ray is intersecting the brush. This is because for a shape with convex angles, remember that all world brushes are convex, you cannot make a ray that would hit an entry plane after an exit plane and still intersect the brush. This algorithm is quite simple and works perfectly in a variety of scenarios. Now, in order to resize the brush, our distance epsilon is included in the fraction formulas for both the entry and exit planes. It's subtracted for entry planes, which makes the fraction smaller, and added for exit planes, which should make the fraction larger, in both cases bringing the fraction points, and by extension planes, away from the brush by epsilon units. However, because exit planes are facing the opposite direction to entry planes, the distance values used in the calculation have opposite signs, which means adding the distance epsilon actually makes the fraction smaller. This causes all exit planes to be virtually shifted into the brush rather than out of it, which creates a couple of spots where a ray can pass through the brush without the collision being detected, as the calculated exit fraction is lower than the entry fraction. This behaviour is what ultimately allows for seam shots. It's worth noting that this glitch really is caused by that one incorrect sign. If epsilon was subtracted in both cases, the exit fraction would be larger, everything would work fine, and seamshots wouldn't exist. Let's take a look at some examples. Here, we have a 90 degree corner made out of two brushes, one simple and one complex. You can see that aiming a ray roughly through the corner allows us to shoot through it. If we now look at how the complex brush is seen by the collision algorithm, we can see a small gap formed where a corner of that brush is, thanks to one of those planes forming the seam being shifted into the brush. However, because the other plane forming the seam is moved out of the brush, the gap is only shootable from a certain range of angles. The closer you are to the simple brush, the easier the shot becomes. The same thing can be observed from the other side of the corner. What's interesting though is that the angle range on one side doesn't match the other, because changing the ray position and direction can affect what planes are considered entry or exit planes, and ultimately change the shape of the gap, or even block it completely in some cases. That's why seamshot gaps can be confusing, because intuitively you would expect the angle ranges to be exactly opposite to each other in this case. Before we look into the in-game presentation, we need to clarify one important thing. To make visualizations of the shifting effect on the collision algorithm easier to see, Epsilon's value is increased to 4 units in the simulation. If we bring it back to the value that's actually used in the game, which is equal to 0.03125 units, or just 2 to the minus 5, the virtual gap becomes impossible to see without zooming in really closely. That's part of why it's so difficult to shoot through these seams. They are extremely small, and deviating our angle or position very slightly can cause the ray to miss. Here's the same brush formation presented in the game. And here's a reconstruction of the gap as seen by the collision algorithm, just so you can see the scale of it. The phenomenon of a seamshot gap changing its shape is more apparent for wall seamshots. Here, we have a simple and a complex brush flush with each other. To be able to shoot through the seam between them, the plane of the complex brush that forms the seam has to be considered an exit plane, so that it would get shifted into the brush, creating an opening. This means that the ray has to face away from the plane rather than into it. As soon as the ray is facing into that plane, it's considered an entry plane, shifting it outwards and covering the gap completely. That's why when attempting wall seam shots, you don't want to be perfectly aligned with the seam, but rather offset towards the complex brush to maximise the angle range. Again, let's switch Epsilon to its original value and zoom in. As you can see, the shot becomes very precise, and even the smallest modification to the ray's starting point or angle can stop the seam shot succeeding. And again, here's the same brush formation in game. You've probably noticed that in the previous examples, only seam shots consisting of one complex and one simple brush are presented, and that's for a reason. If we were to replace that simple brush with a complex one, the gap is completely covered regardless of how the ray approaches. This is because if we manage to make the face of one brush move inwards to create a virtual gap, the face in the other brush becomes an entry plane since it's facing the other direction and is moved outwards, ultimately cancelling out the incorrect behaviour and leaving no gap to shoot through. A similar behaviour can be observed in the corner example. There are, however, two conditions that can make shooting through such a seam possible. Firstly, if any of the planes making a seam were angled in the right way, then the shifted planes would change the behaviour of the collision, occasionally forming a gap through which we can shoot, as shown in this example. However, these brush shapes are quite unusual, and in practice you rarely see them in maps. The second condition utilises BSP tree leaves. In the Source engine, every map is separated into regions called leaves, with each brush being contained within at least one leaf. Since leaves are generated to fit the brush layout, they usually match the brush shape, although that's not always the case. As an optimization, if the ray doesn't pass through any leaf containing the brush, the collision with it is not tested. This means that if two complex brushes are next to each other and in separate leaves, we can shoot a ray that doesn't intersect the leaf of the other brush, completely ignoring it and creating a situation similar to the seam shot with a complex and simple brush. This makes it an interesting case, as you can actually choose which brush you want to shoot through, giving you more options for the shot. That's everything you need to know about seam shots from a technical perspective, how they are the result of a single incorrect character in the complex brush collision code, and what conditions have to be met in order to shoot through a seam. But how can they actually be used in practice? In Portal games, they're quite useful for speedruns, as they give access to portalable walls which allow us to save time. In Portal 1, the most notable ones are 04 and 06 in the Out of Bounds category, as well as a couple of individual level strategies. In Portal 2, seam shots are used in Repulsion Intro and Crazy Box for full game runs, and in Incinerator and Secret Panel for challenge mode runs. As mentioned, seam shots are present in all Source games, including popular titles like Team Fortress 2 and CSGO. Their actual use is limited there, but there's a high chance there could be some interesting ones hiding in plain sight. In the description, you'll find a link to a GitHub repository containing the Unity project used to create visualizations for this video. There's also another repository linked with a small program that parses a given Portal 2 BSP map and returns a set of draw line commands that will highlight all shootable seams in it, in case you'd like to hunt for some seams. Hopefully you've learned something new and enjoyed this video. Thanks for watching.